equal and different. Our country is named after the Koinonia, La Trinidad. But it is anything but that right now. Of course, the individualism, the crass individualism, then feeds the materialism. Because it's now a question of what Ari Noy, one of the great spiritual writers of our time, calls the acquisitiveness of the culture. So the individualism feeds the materialism, and the materialism is involved in acquiring the acquisitiveness of the culture. And then the snowballing goes on and on from there, triggering all kinds of other social and geographical avalanches. Violent crime, corruption, environmental degradation. I am going to put my house wherever I want it, so I'm going to destroy this hill to do it. And you have to take the high post, who fell out after that fellow. That is where it leads. And if we don't pick up the thread of the trend and snip it somewhere, we're in trouble. You see, I don't think that we have quite grasped how far-reaching the consequences of individualism and acquisitiveness and self-gratification are. And so too with the absence of skills of communication and dialogue and the attitudes of, lack of recognition and respect. With the absence of those things, what is absent is what the famous Jewish philosopher Martin Buber called the I-thou relationship. I-thou. And what takes the place of that instead is the I-it relationship. I am I. Or you're it. And you have to serve my purpose. And therefore, since it is an I-it relationship, the I always feel comfortable to exploit and to extinguish the it, if necessary, with survival as a prime goal and objective. So what has happened over the last 3 years is what one of my most respected senior colleagues, Professor Neville Donovan, has said. He said to me some time ago, yes, there is a certain coarseness that has taken over our societies. A certain coarseness. So, with the Racehorse Scholarship Interpol Championship, raw competitiveness, schooling, and that's another word we can look at. It's not the same as education. Schooling is not the same as education. Anyway, we leave that for the debate. With that, we have produced a lot of stars. Lots of stars. Brilliant people. But many of whom are hopeless in their family and workplace relationships. Some of them who I know personally from even my time, the college that I went to have committed suicide because they can't cook anymore. Brilliant men. But friends, the Christian gospel is a countercultural gospel in situations of this kind. Because if anyone is in Christ, there is a new creation. So the gospel is always challenging us to create a new way of being and relating to others and to nature and the environment. I've always found it interesting that at the end of St. Mark's gospel, when Jesus gives the the gospel. He tells them to preach it to all creation. In other commissions, it's different, but in Mark, it is to all creation. So our relationship has to be altered. And what does it mean? What does it take to facilitate the development of a formation of persons, young persons, of persons in Christ? What does it mean, and what does it take to do that? And what resources are our churches prepared to put behind that? The formation of persons, particularly in areas of deficiency that I have identified earlier, and in many other areas. First of all, I'll say, and then let me just tie up with my Scottish time, ongoing process. That question of equipping and forming people, not equipping them, but forming them, is an ongoing process. It is a question of developing and cultivating a sensitivity and awareness of the other as other, a sensitivity. There's a little grocery across the way from UWI, St. Augustine. Okay, it's close to the highway side. And it's still called the same thing, but it used to be called U-W-W-E. That is another version, that is the local version of Martin Luther's I Know. U-W-E. And there is a time that, and there's a leadership role for the churches in this country to call our country and its diverse roots together and to sit comfortably in an I-Thou relationship, in a you-we relationship. Imagine political parties are saying that they're trying that before the church is here. And the church has a commission to go and preach the gospel and to preach this new man, this new person in Christ. So that posture of you being is very important. It's not a you, it's not an I-it relationship. So the other thing I want to say is that the setting of spaces for encounter, conducive spaces for encounter and dialogue, wherever they are. And again, I want to come back to this space and congratulate those who have been year after year cultivating this space. Very important. And the question of embracing the stranger is what I call hospitality. Again, I'm borrowing a thought from Ari Noen. I think he's one of the most profound writers of the day. And Ari Noen has three movements, one of which is from hostility to hospitality. Right now, we're certainly in hostility mode. What is it going to take to move us from hostility to hospitality, where we can embrace the other and be comfortable in the same space? I think I want to introduce a notion which I call beyond curriculum. Class is beyond curriculum. In another sense, it is a curriculum vitae. In the true sense of that word, it is a setting of the course of life, the curriculum vitae, the course of life of persons in the way of Christ. I just want to end by saying two words about the Passion Near People program. As Reverend Clifford would have mentioned at the start, I have the honor and the privilege as a younger theologian working on that program, Christian education material, with the person who was the director of that program, directly with the wonderful woman, Reverend Dr. Joyce Bailey, now deceased, visionary woman. And in a sense, like before, I have to lament that that project has come to naught. Because it was perhaps the only project that I knew of, the heads of churches of the CCC sat down and commissioned officially. And in those days, a $1 million US project was bringing writers from all over the Caribbean in different workshops to write, and then of course, I would be on loan from Idris Hamid and Nolly running up to Joyce until Idris started to quarrel. Remember that, Nolly? Say that they see that as the new staff member and what they're taking this man away for every time in Jamaica and so on. So then I had to stop. But I used to be in Jamaica like a month at a time working on the material, the fashion young people, helping Joyce to edit it. And you know, it is so sad, it's past fun, it's sad. From the outset, it was made very clear, and it was agreed, that the peculiar or particular emphases of the different denominations could not be accommodated in a program that was in a curriculum that was ecumenical. It was agreed that each denomination would supplement its own particular emphases in certain areas. A curriculum of that nature could not accommodate a Baptist version of Baptism, understanding of Baptism, a Roman Catholic understanding of Eucharist, and so on and so on. That was understood. Suddenly, all kinds of faults and failings and complaints started to arise. People were not seeing their own denomination reflected at this and that and the other. And materials went to no use. Before we closed the office in Barbados, there was a particular room which housed only productions, printed productions of the CCC. And in that room, there was a rocket set of these fashion new people things. I remember at a staff meeting, one of my colleagues, when we were discussing how exactly we were going to go about phasing the closure and what we had to do. A senior colleague said, "Mr. Granado, please do not let us dump any of these materials on the dump." He said it would be really something that shows us up very badly. He said, "Let us organize, and I'm willing to do it, to get the fire services of Barbados to destroy the material by incinerating. We can't have this thing flying all over the dump." And it was not only passionate people. It was all other serious material. Robert Cuthbert's books, Development and Ecumenism, and so on. My then executive assistant wrote out to several places, churches, theological institutions, and so on, saying, "Look, this is the material we have. Do you want it? You can just have to pay for the postage. We give it to you free." Probably three persons then wrote back saying that they would take it. But coming close to the end of my stay, instead of that, the youth, the representative of another church came to inform me that their church had just commissioned the writing of their own curriculum. And so they just wanted to be courteous and let us know. Anyway, I leave it there, and I leave it to the discussion to elaborate on some other things. Thank you very much for the opportunity. As I say, my duty, as I saw it, was to lay a framework, and I